The dignity of the dais sense. Let me first begin with the thanks of the organizer for inviting me here to give a keynote address on a very important topic of privatization and Dalit question. And on the eve of upcoming election, the issue of privatization and Dalit and the reservation in the private sector going to be projected through this conference or seminar. This is an important issue, and in another 45 minutes or so, I would like to share my views on this particular topic. This is a very controversial topic. Topic which is debated, and therefore there are several issues which have come up in the discussion when this issue was taken on the agenda by the government. To say on the time, let me give you a background, a little background. When the new economic policy or what is called liberalization or structural adjustment program began in the early 90s, that policy, among many other things, that is liberalization, deregulation, involved one of the important features was privatization of industry, privatization of many other spheres. And when the first budget was presented by then Prime Minister Dr.Sukhadeo Thorat, the group in Delhi prepared an alternative budget. Some of you may be knowing about the alternative budget. When the main budget was presented, second day the alternative budget was presented somewhere in the Gandhi or somewhere, making a point that alternative is possible to address the problem. The next year, the second alternative budget was brought in, and I was approached by the main person of the alternative budget that I should write as to what is the implications, what are the consequences of new economic policy involving privatization and liberalization on the rate. During the year, I had become a little more concerned about the new economic policy, particularly the privatization. And I wrote an article as back as 1994. That was probably the first article upon which I have expressed concern and made a point that how the new economic policy, policy of privatization, is going to reduce the space that the Dalit, particularly the Shadow tribe, and then at that time OBC is the Russian was not there. In the state it was, but not at the center. How it is going to reduce the little space that the Shadow tribe had got through reservation in government, jobs in public sector undertaking, in national insurance, in nationalized commercial bank, and the government education institute. In other words, government job and government related job. So I argued at that time, this is a backdoor reservation, de-reservation. Officers Association in Delhi organized a seminar in Indian Social Institute where they invited the finance minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh. And many speakers spoke and I spoke, and I point out the concern and the negative consequences of privatization on the reservation. To which the finance minister at that time agreed that yes, there are going to be consequences and there is a need that something should be done in the private sector. From 1992 to 1994 to 2008, when the affirmative action policy in the present form was accepted by the private sector, Confederation of Indian Industry, Associate Chamber of Commerce and FICCI. The agreement was reached between the Prime Minister's office and the industrial sector that they accept some sort of an affirmative action policy. During this 1994 to 2008, that is for 12 years, there was a huge debate between those who argued that reservation or affirmative action policy is not necessary in the private sector and those who argued that yes, there is a need. For 10 years, 12 years, series of articles in the newspaper, series of program on the TV, this job was given to Madam Meera Kumar, who was the Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment, to negotiate with the private sector. So there were several of negotiations. Nothing much came out. Things moved forward a little. Nothing came out. So it was transferred to the Commerce Ministry. Kamal Nath Ji was the chairman of the ministry at that time. He was given a job to negotiate with the minister, with the private sector. There also there was no success, so it was taken over by the Prime Minister's office directly. And Dr. Manmohan Singh convinced the private sector that there is a need to have some sort of an affirmative action policy, otherwise there will be a demand for legal law at the reservation in the form of the law. And somehow then in 2008, the agreement has been reached and we have an affirmative action policy for the private sector, which I will share with you, its positive aspect and its limitation. And in the present context. The debate was so intense that by that time I had taken a 4-year leave and joined, I set up an institute called Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. And then on behalf of that Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment asked us to take two studies. One, that please give us the example of other countries where there is a reservation or affirmative action policy in private sector. We did a study for 13 countries submitted to the ministry to strengthen their hand. Then they asked us to do another study that please do a study what are the tax concession and other concession given by the government to the private sector. We did that. These were all arguments in favor of some sort of an affirmative action policy for the private sector. So much of debate went on that I put all those 300 or 200 odd articles, 250 articles, and brought out a book that was the first book, Reservation in Private Sector, Quest for Economic Growth and Equal Opportunity. That puts all the arguments in there. Now, in fact, this is the background of the reservation policy in which I was. Now that discussion is being divided through this conference and I think there will be a big conference tomorrow on the privatization and the other issues. Now, therefore I would like to submit the issues and arguments on the question of reservation in private sector or affirmative action policies in private sector. I will also bring out the difference between what is the affirmative action and how does it differ from the Indian variety of affirmative action policy. That is reservation. Let me go into the little bit of theory and then I come to the actual Indian situation. Because that theory is necessary because I have not only argued with the those who oppose reservation. But I also argued with those who talks about the general solution to the problem of discriminated group of shared caste and the There is a branch of academicians who argue that general economic empowerment is good enough even to address the problem of not only Dalit and not only other but also Dalit. And some of the Marxists also took their position. Now, the Marxian position on the issue of caste emerged out of the traditional thinking of relation between superstructure and basic structure. Although all along the left and Marxist parties have supported the issues of reservation, but in the academic, the position has been influenced by the traditional theorization of relationship between superstructure and basic structure in the Marxian tradition. So I would like to sort of touch upon that. After the death of Karl Marx, the clarification was sought from Engels about the role of the economic factors in the poverty and the miseries and the entire historical development. And to that, Engels replied, his letter is included, he replied, that look, what Marx and I have said, I am quoting, what Marx and I have said is that all happening in the history and the society is because of multiple factors. The economics and non-economics, the superstructure and the economic structure. All events are determined by these two categories of factors. But ultimately, Engels says, ultimately, it is the economic factors which influence the course of the history. Please understand carefully, student, but it is the economic factor which ultimately influences. And then Engels go on to add that neither Marx nor I have said anything beyond this. I am quoting Engels. And if any economic, any Marxist go on to say that everything is determined by the economic factor, then he said, I am not a Marxist. What he said, that economic factors are predominant. But he also went on and go ahead and said that look, different factors, maybe superstructural and economic factor, influence the society at different stages in the history. And if the superstructure factors are important, they need to be dealt with. That is the correct interpretation of Engels, of at least on the relationship between superstructure and the infrastructure. Yes. When Dr. Ambedkar began to argue in 1920s with Dambe Ardhi Devi and set up an independent labor party, Ambedkar set up, first party was independent labor party before he set up Scheduled Caste Federation and later on the Republican Party of India. The major difference that he argued with Dambe and Ardhi Devi was that look, caste play an important role. Is there any problem with the voice? No. Caste play an important role. So, from 1920, after the setting up of Communist Party, and when Ambedkar began to work with the Communists in the Independent Party, Communists supported Ambedkar, Ambedkar supported Communists, and in the first provincial election in 1937, 13 candidate member of assembly were elected. Some of them were Marxists, supported by Marxists and Ambedkar. But from 1925 onward, till very recent, the Communist Party of India, or a Marxist thinker, never accepted caste as a problem. And they were sensitive, they recognized, they supported. But there was no proper theorization as to how caste interacted with class and how do we deal with caste. And Ambedkar had laid down certain hypotheses. In Annihilation of Caste, he argued that you have to deal with the issue of caste because it has a material base. It has an ideological base, but it has a material base also. Now, and you hold that position. Now, I don't want to go into that detail, but I want to share with you certain realities of today and then come to the issue of reservation, private sector, or affirmative private sector. What is the problem of Dalit? Let me limit the discussion. There are two features which has been immediately identified by the academician with respect to the problem of untouchable, and to a certain extent some portion of ODCs. But basically the untouchable. Reservation policy really began with untouchable. It just was extended to tribals. So but the causality and the reason as to why it should be there, it real justification began with the untouchable. Now what are the difference between the poor belonging to the discriminated group of untouchable and poor belonging to non-discriminated? That's the crux of the matter. Both are poor. Ambedkar had visualized many address in Manmad, in Maharashtra, in front of the labor conference, conference of the railway employees. Is a laborer or the laborer, worker or the worker, you suffer from the system. But here is railway organization and many other organizations, particularly railway, where the untouchable worker have a separate pot to take out water. They are not employed in certain categories of work. They sit separately and eat. So workers are workers and yet they are divided. And therefore we call it independent labor party. And the justification was there that the labor belonging to the scheduled caste and untouchables have their additional problem besides the problem of poverty. They have additional economic problems, so they need to be treated, to which the Dangle and Randhive hardly responded in a positive way. Not for any other reason, but theorization. In the same year, in 1936, in Annihilation of Caste, he wrote, that Marx could say that the proletariat have nothing to lose except the chain of slavery, of exploitation. But here is the workers belonging to the high caste fear to lose certain privileges that they enjoy over the poor from the untouchable. That is why they wrote drink from the same pot, that is why they don't live in the same locality, that is why they don't intermarry. That is why they don't suffer from discrimination, that is why they get access to education, the untouchable do not. So the proletariat was divided on the basis of superstructure, caste. And the high caste proletariat, they do not join in some of their demands. So Ambedkar is mentioned. The proletariat ness bring the proletariat fraternity. Worker being common, commonly exploited, being a common fraternity and brotherhood. But here, that brotherhood is not there. There is a division. The worker who fight for the higher wages, same workers in their personal life and in their some aspect of social life are divided. There is no fraternity. And therefore Ambedkar argued that caste is not a division of labor, it's a division of labor. So here is the lack of fraternity. And then Ambedkar argued that if workers are not involved, united. It's untouchable one would feel that I am not on par with my friend who is a philanthropist and I am a philanthropist. How do you form an united front for the liberation? So Ambedkar did argue in a nation of class, very famous sentence quoted by many, that you turn left or you turn right, caste is the obstacle which is come in your way in mobilization of the worker or mobilization of the Hindus for any right cause. So therefore he argued that the Marxist and the proletarian organization will have to include the issue of caste on their agenda, increase the confidence of untouchable worker in the high caste worker that keep them unequal. Ambedkar made an argument that the promise of the Marxist, promise of the proletariat, that look, let the revolution come, let there be equalization of economic property, and we will treat you equally, that promise will not help as long as in the present life you continue to discriminate, you continue to maintain differences and lack of fraternity and brotherhood. No confidence will be. So therefore you have to address that issue. Now this theorization is very important. We have come long way. Randhiwe later on they wrote, in the booklet by Randhiwe where he recognized, he changed his position. Then there are other writings that have come. We have come long way, and this conference is the recognition of the fact that we have to bring the issue of caste, individuality and discrimination on that. Now let me come to the issue of private sector and affirmative action. I have begun by saying that there is a difference between the poor belonging to the scheduled untouchable and the poor belonging to the high caste. They are a heterogeneous category. They are a similar category in some respect, but they are dissimilar category in another respect. The problem of untouchable worker are additionally aggravated because of the denial of economic and educational and other rights because of caste, which is not the problem of the high caste poor. So, although the source of poverty for the high caste and other poor is landlessness, unemployment, unequal distribution of the asset, which results into lack of education, lack of employability, higher unemployment rate, working of the capitalist system itself, which creates inequality in the process of growth. These are the processes which are typically Marxist analysis, affect equally the high caste and the low caste group. And that should be recognized. Those who say that caste is the only factor, they are wrong. The factors that affect everybody's life are similarly affect to the untouchable as well as not. Remember that. Therefore, Ambedkar described caste as enclosed class. Way back in 1960 in a Columbia paper where he developed the theory of caste. So the causes for the deprivation of workers are similar. They are systemic and there are outcome in terms of lack of access to assets, lack of access to education, lack of access to employment and poverty. These factors are similar for both. But there is an additional factor which aggravates the situation of the scheduled caste and untouchable. And that is that because of their social origin and because of their caste background, they are denied certain rights which the poor from the high caste enjoy. Remember, historically, the untouchable did not have right to property. Well, the high caste worker had. Untouchable did not have right to private enterprises except the polluting occupation, which the high class poor had. Untouchable did not have right to education in the beginning of the Britishers, which the high class poor had. Women did not have right to property and education, similarly to the Dalit, till the beginning of the Britishers, where the Britishers introduced the concept of private property and open education system. Now that is the difference. That while the poor from the non-discriminated group, non-Dalit group, suffer from the general economic factors that are associated with the working of the private economy, not having access to asset, exploitative relations and others, Dalit also suffer from that. But additionally, the The economic deprivation of the Dalit is also because of the customary rule of the caste. I am not talking of civil and cultural rights, I am talking of caste, economic rights. The customary rule of the caste system denied the right to property, right to business and right to education. I am taking only material factors, I am not taking social and cultural. In many states, these customary rights of denial of property were also converted into a property law. The classical example is Punjab. In Punjab, 1901, a act was passed under which untouchable were not allowed to buy the land. The Britishers had a private property and they had the right to land. But untouchable were by that act were not allowed to purchase the land. Caste system theory was introduced. That only landowning classes, namely Jat, will have a right to purchase the land. Not even Brahmi. So that. As a result, from 1901 to 1947, when this act was, it's called Punjab Land Alienation Act. In 47, Sir Shotula repealed this act. So for 45 years, untouchable could not buy land, even if they have money to buy land. Many of the Dalit had gone into Nidhi. They had money, they wanted to buy land, they were not allowed. As a result of which, in Punjab, by 2010 or 11, NSS survey, 95% of the scheduled class in Punjab are landless. Those restrictions still continue. The land is sold within the caste. Now, this is not the problem of the high caste poor. Remember, those who argue for the common approach towards the poor from high caste and other categories like Muslim or other, and poor from the scheduled class, forget to draw a distinction of a special disability that the Dalit worker faces or person faces. So the Dalits are different, are similar to the high caste poor insofar as they also lack land, they also lack resources. But the channel of lacking of resources, please understand me properly, the channel through which the landlessness and other things come amongst the Dalit is the customary rule of the caste, not of capitalism, remember, not of feudalism. This is the difference. This is the mistake that some of the Marxist theorists have now communicated. Landlessness comes through the working of capitalist system, landlessness comes through the feudalism. Certainly. Polarization takes place through working of the capitalist system and the feudal system. But for the untouchable, additionally, the landlessness comes also through the customary rules of the caste system. And therefore, you see the gap between the poor belonging to the higher caste and the poor belonging to the non-excluded community and poor belonging to the excluded community. I think if you understand this factor, then you resolve your riddle between the issue of discriminated poor and non-discriminated poor, and you will then resolve the issue of policy. I come to the policy now. And the untouchable suffer denial of equal right in economic sphere, because the Anti-Untouchability Act of 1955 and the Atrocity Act of 1989 only talk about social and cultural rights. It doesn't talk about economic rights. It doesn't talk about discrimination in the school, colleges, primary health center, government scheme. We have a lot of studies. So, this difference need to be addressed. Now, then, if this is the case, you can very easily see the consequences of denial of equal right to the Dalit. Denial of equal right in poverty, property, asset, education, and then, of course, employment. I just want to give the figure for all India and